Welcome to Rolling Stone Music Now. I'm Rolling Stone executive editor Nathan Brackett. Today we're going to talk about the new movie from Lonely Island, Popstar, Never Stop, Never Stopping, and the art of the music parody. We're also going to talk about the new Car Seat Headrest record and also answer some reader mail about Phish. But first, today's episode of Rolling Stone Music Now is brought to you by Stamps.com. Buy and print official U.S. postage using your own computer and printer. You can sign up for Stamps.com and get a four-week trial and a $110 bonus offer when you use the promo code MUSIC. And that was Photo Booth by Joey Purp. This is our What We're Listening To segment, and I'm here with Rolling Stone Record Reviews editor John Dolan. What's up, John?
Hey, Nathan.
I love that Joey Purp song. You played it for me for the first time a couple weeks ago, and there's like some songs that you like hear it within the first 3 seconds. It's like you know you love this song, and you're going to be hearing it more.
It's true. The beat is so dirty. The horns sort of got like, if it's like the Famous Flames, like playing a party in hell or something. It's just got this really raw intensity to it. And Joey Purp is a Chicago rapper. He's kind of an associate of Chance the Rapper. And
The new Chance the Rapper album.
He is, right? And Chance the Rapper appears on his new mixtape, which just came out. And it's not dissimilar musically. The horns are a big factor, and there's kind of a little bit of the gospel element or the element of sort of struggle and redemption. But it's the sort of dark side of that. It's, you know, songs about friends going to prison, and you know, I see myself in my mom's eyes, and being on both sides of the burner and stuff like that. And
yeah, so as we talked about last episode, the Chance the Rapper record coloring book, which is also excellent, is also like super positive, has a lot of gospel music and stuff. So this is a little dirtier.
This kind of offers maybe just like an addendum or an sort of the example of what Chance the Rapper is sort of talking about trying to transcend, while acknowledging he kind of talks about embodying. But the music is exciting. There's party jams. It's just a really great mixtape, and this song especially is standout.
All right. Well, we encourage people to check out Joey Purp. The other song that you brought to the table today is from a group called The Hotelier, but we're not holding that name against them.
We're not. We tried. It's been tough, but they've transcended their name just as Chance the Rapper transcends struggle. This was a band, it was going around, people talking about it. The cover of the album is just a bunch of naked people standing in a meadow. And with the combination of that and the name The Hotelier, I kind of thought maybe it'd be some sort of like creepy neo-folk gross thing.
Or a Spencer Tunick shoot.
Right, totally,
or,
exactly. Yeah. And it was funny because like people are talking about it on social media and stuff. When it's ever on Facebook, they have to scrub the album title immediately off. And if you look on Spotify, it's blurred out and stuff. But it's actually a really good indie rock album. These kind of remind me of the herky-jerky guitar music of the Dismemberment Plan, or the kind of like post-REM Athens, Georgia bands, maybe like Guadalcanal Diary, a little bit, sort of a mix of different things. And it's just wide open sort of guitar music, and much as the people on the cover are bare naked, the emotionalism in the songs is bare naked as well. It's a good record.
A couple of the songs took a while to creep up on me, but they got there.
They start slow. It's kind of one of those things where the songs start off, you're kind of like, this is going to turn out sort of average. And by the middle, you're like, this is awesome. It's kind of, the opposite of how things often work out. But the album's called Goodness. It just came out about a week ago. And there's a song on the record called Opening My Grandmother's Mail. So it's that kind of record. Like, get ready for that. You're going to have to deal with a little bit of that, but I think it's worth your time.
The final thing that we're listening to that we're going to talk about today is the Car Seat Headrest album, which is just awesome. Maybe saving the best for last. This is my favorite album probably of the last month or so.
I think I would say a contender for the, one of the best albums of the year. It's just
absolutely
a fantastic record. We've talked about them. We're writing about them. We are in the car seat. We are behind the car seat. Wherever the car seat's going, we will definitely be looking over his shoulder. It's just, I don't know, if you ever liked indie rock, if you've ever liked Pavement or Guided by Voices or The Replacements, if you've ever found any of these things, it's Rick. He is
Indie Rock Nation.
It really is like the combination of the way that his name is Will Toledo. He's been around. He's made many. He's kind of the greatest talent to come out of the kind of Bandcamp diaspora of these people putting up tons and tons of music on Bandcamp or SoundCloud or whatever. And he's been doing that for a little while. The mythology behind him is that he was this suburban kid in Virginia who would, before going to his work at his job at like a Guess Jeans place or whatever, he would stop, pull into a mall parking lot and write these songs sitting in his car and record them. And he'd
be staring at a car seat headrest.
And he has any preternatural gifts as a songwriter that come out. And on this one, he got a real band. He started to think about how could I write life songs. And so it's self-doubting, but it's anthemic. It's catchy, but it's distended. It's just got all these qualities. He is the kind of shabby Bastards of Young style anthemic quality of Paul Westerberg, with the kind of Pavement, you know, golden, off in the distant sunset romanticism, with the sort of late 60s Who power pop side that you heard in Guided by Voices and bands like that, all kind of at once in this molten form almost. And this is the record where he really shows that he's a talent that will, you know, if he continues on this course, could be making great albums like this. You know, we could be talking about him in 20 years. It's just
And this definitely, I mean, for my money, this is definitely the record to get from him. I mean, I've enjoyed some of his stuff in the past, Teens of Style from last year, but this one's called, I forget if we mentioned, Teens of Denial. It's his first full band record. And talk about like an artist that like builds to real like crescendos. Like the chorus on Drunk Drivers is like one of my favorite things.
We were talking about
this
Drunk
year.
Drivers, Killer Whales is a song where he starts off kind of moldering in his own sort of doubts about life and doubts about the world, but the guitars kind of push him to fight through and struggle through.
But if we learn how to live like this, maybe we can learn how to start again. Like a child who's never done wrong.
Get to this point where he's, you know, yelling, it doesn't have to be this way. We don't need drunk drivers and we don't need this sort of dark things in life. We're going to make the world our own. He's going to come through this song and give you a hug. It's just an amazing moment on a record that's full of them. It really is it might be one of the best indie rock records of all time. It's a great record.
Wow. Okay.
I will hammer on this table and claim it.
You also said preternatural, which means that you must be a record review editor.
Something like that.
That's Car Seat Headrest's Teens of Denial. John Dolan, thanks for coming on.
You bet. Thank you.
If you run your own business, constant trips to the post office can get in the way. With Stamps.com, you'll be able to spend less time at the post office and more time growing your business. Stamps.com makes mailing and shipping easy. You can use your own computer and printer to buy and print official U.S. postage for any letter or any package. Right now, you can sign up for Stamps.com and use the promo code MUSIC for this special offer. You get a 4-week trial plus a $110 bonus offer, including postage and a digital scale. So don't wait. Go to stamps.com, click on the microphone at the top of the homepage, and type in MUSIC. That's stamps.com, enter MUSIC.
I'm a superstar, I kick down the door. Got the money in the bills, and I'm also so humble.
I'm so humble. I'm so humble.
And that was I'm So Humble from the new movie from Lonely Island, pop star, Never Stop, Never Stopping.
Connor for real, yo.
I have here David Fear, senior editor for film and TV for RollingStone.com and Rolling Stone in general. And I have the great Rob Sheffield.
Hey, Nathan.
Who needs no introduction?
Who needs no introduction? We're going to talk about Popstar, and we're also going to talk about just music parodies in general and why music parodies are often better than just normal films about music.
I think that's a fair thing to say. I mean, think about how many music biopics we've seen. I mean, especially in the last, I don't know, 10 to 15 years. And I mean, now they either follow one or two tracks. They're very kind of like Cradle to Grave, in which you see the young Ray Charles or the young Johnny Cash, their formative years, their childhood traumas. And then there's that kind of eureka moment of like, hey, I just discovered I Walk the Line, or I just discovered What I Say. And then it goes through their ups and downs, success and the rise and the fall. And the
walk on the beach.
Exactly, the rehab, exactly.
Right, yeah.
The second act, which there's supposed to be none of those in American Lives, and yet every music biopic essentially, you know, throws that out the window. Or you now have these things where they take one very specific period of a musician's life and they essentially make a biopic out of that. Like Miles Ahead is a great example of this, in which rather than make a movie, or really given Miles' career, like 7 or 8 different movies about how he kept reinventing music, Don Cheadle, who wrote and directed and stars in the film, concentrates on a period of Miles' life mostly when he wasn't making music. And he introduces these fictional characters to kind of get at what Werner Herzog called an ecstatic truth, and takes this entire notion of like this guy who kept making music and what happens to him when he can't do that anymore. So you know, even that's starting to become kind of a cliche.
Right.
I mean, you can see it in Love and Mercy too, where they take two of those things. Yeah, I see why they do it.
Because musicians' lives are messy. Like, yeah. I mean, everybody's life is messy, but musicians' lives especially too. And so right. that's a way to kind of drill down. And
but with music parodies, very often you guys are getting either actors, comedians, or actor/comedians who are real musicians or who have a real affection and ability to play this kind of music as close to the real thing as possible. And when you do parodies like that, I mean, that's kind of why Weird Al's had an entire career for these decades. That's really what the Lonely Island, who are the people behind Popstar, have kind of made their bones doing. And
right.
when you watch a film like Spinal Tap, all those guys were real musicians, essentially in a real band.
Right.
Or Popstar, it's amazing to see how close they get to this thing and how funny they get by, to use Sandberg's words, we want to get as close to the real thing as possible and then just amp it up to this absurd level. And that's
right.
what makes Popstar to me like easily the best music parody since Spinal Tap.
Wow.
That's a bold statement.
Considering the genre is not that big, not so bold, but
Spinal Tap of the 21st century? I need some time to process the statement. I did see the movie last night, Rob. I know you haven't seen it yet, but I saw it last night. I can attest that it's very funny. There's very, very funny moments. I don't know if
CB4 is a mighty lofty standard to reach.
CB4 does
Chris
have
Rock's
some...
classic... gangster rap parody movie at the time when that seemed like a niche genre, and it was the first big Chris Rock movie. It was the first time we had a chance to see him on screen for a couple hours the way we'd wanted to for all those years he was on Saturday Night Live, getting one sketch once a month in the last 10 minutes. And for something as sustained and loving as CB4, Just a startlingly great movie.
Keep in mind, I have nothing. I mean, there are days when I will sing Sweat on My Balls, like, you know,
love it.
The classic CB4 cut, you know, to my kid when I'm putting her to sleep or, you know, when we're walking about the neighborhood. I actually thought that last year when the NWA biopic came out, they were going to make Straight Outta Low Cash. biopic of the CB4 thing. No, well, CB4 is a great movie.
CB4 was great, too, because, I mean... one thing that Chris Rock said, I think, at the time with NWA, or maybe a little bit after, because Chris Rock is a huge hip-hop fan. He's really smart about this stuff. He said, like, one thing that struck him that nobody ever got about NWA was how funny they were, how they were kind of a comedy act. Like, a lot of their stuff is really funny. You know, a lot of their lines. And CB4 got, like, revealed that truth in, like, Technicolor, you know? It was, there's a lot. And he clearly loved the music.
Loved the music and got like the actual names in the genre to, you know, to play along and actually, you know, make their commentaries. It was so,
right.
And that was before we knew like, you know, Ice-T's dramatic chops. So
right.
seeing him talk about CB4 and its influence on him. And he's, you know,
right.
I thought I was hard, man.
Right. Well, all right, first off though, let's back up for a second. We'll talk a little bit about Popstar. David, you interviewed all the guys for the magazine and the website.
Did, yeah.
You obviously love the movie. Can you tell us a little bit about, you know, what it is, the basic premise of it for people who haven't seen it?
Right. I'll back up a couple of steps. So the three guys in the Lonely Islands, Andy Samberg, Yorma Taccone, and Akiva Schaffer, had been wanting to make feature-length film for a while. They had done Hot Rod and it didn't do so great, and they wanted to do something that they said was a little bit more in line with what they were doing in their digital shorts for SNL. And coincidentally, they had started watching what they call Popumentaries, which are like the One Direction film or the Katy Perry film. It's Katy Perry, Part of Me, and the Justin Bieber film, Never Say Never.
We should do an episode entirely on those, actually. That's a good genre.
We should deep dive.
Right.
A Popumentary deep dive.
Right.
And they had started thinking, well, these genres, it's very funny just on its own watching these kind of promo docs that these bands are putting out. And it would be really funny to like parody this. And it's a great excuse for us to do music. And it's a great excuse for us to do the sort of jokes that we find funny. And so they started putting together this kind of composite pop star that was a lot of Justin Bieber and a little bit of Katy Perry and a little bit of Adam Levine and a little bit of some hip-hop stars. They actually mentioned The Carter, which is that great Lil Wayne documentary that never quite got released because he sort of squashed it.
Right.
As something they kept going back to and taking inspiration from. And they get Connor For Real, who was this kid who's, like Justin Bieber, was this like drum prodigy when he was a baby. And then formed this kind of Beastie Boys meets a Backstreet Boys band called the Style Boys. I mean, you guys all remember the Donkey Roll, right?
Of course.
Who wasn't doing the Donkey Roll in 1986? Great dance. And then becomes this solo artist and starts selling out stadiums and hits this like Bieber level of pop, being a pop juggernaut. And the entire film is essentially like a mockumentary about this guy and how he becomes this huge pop star and has all the kind of excesses that you associate with a pop star now. And then kind of hits a flop and goes through a bad patch. And then he has to get back to with his friends and his ex-bandmates to kind of find his voice again. And it's incredibly funny. It's a great excuse for these guys to send this kind of stuff up and just put in a lot of great jokes and a lot of great songs.
I think somebody said that it kind of feels like a little bit like an 86-minute long digital short. And I kind of agree with that, but I don't see that. That's not a bad thing. I mean, there's some incredibly funny stuff. Like the Macklemore parody song, God. The Same Love parody,
is not gay, but if I was, I would want equal rights. And then he just keeps reminding people that he's not gay every other verse by occasionally shouting out titties and Leonard Skinner and push-ups. I've seriously been listening to that song and that soundtrack since I saw the movie. I think it's so funny.
I mean, it's funny that you said that they said at least that they were watching popumentaries and those were like the inspiration for that. Because, I mean, as we kind of touched on before, it's like just about almost every good movie about music like Spinal Tap or CB4 has had this mockumentary format. Like, why do you think that is?
I think partially because a lot of these mockumentaries – I'll put it to you this way. You don't need to love Ray Charles to make a biopic about Ray Charles. But if you're going to make a mockumentary, if you're going to kind of affectionately send up this genre and not do it in a really mean-spirited, you know, F you kind of way, you need to have a real affection and affinity for this kind of stuff. And chances are you even have an ability to kind of play this sort of music. Like all the guys in Spinal Tap were accomplished musicians, much less metal musicians.
Right.
Which is why the songs in Spinal Tap sound as close to the real thing, to actual metal songs, as possible. And, you know, anyone who's seen the digital shorts, who's seen Dick in a Box or Jizz in My Pants or Lazy Sunday, the kind of stuff that these guys made their names with on SNL, you know that they know how to do that kind of 90s R&B really well, or they know how to do this kind of modern pop stuff with a little bit of like hip hop and EDM thrown in really, really well.
Right. Like the Dick in the Box probably did more for like Color Me Bad's legacy than anything in the last like 20 years.
Absolutely.
Yeah. But also it's a genre like a lot of genres that inspire these movies that is best approached as comedy because it's the most emotionally accurate way to come to it. And boy band parodies have been as popular as boy bands have. Together, the MTV movie about the documentary that had Chris Farley's brother Kevin as the leader of Together, who had the hit Me plus You equals Us, Calculus.
That was absolutely
classic. If you remember the movie Josie and the Pussycats, there was the great boy band parody that Seth Green starred in, like in 2001.
Absolutely, yeah.
Du jour, like, which was perfect. This is a genre where being funny about it is the best way to get at the emotional truths that make the music popular in the first place.
Although you can do it in a mean-spirited way and still be really funny. I keep going back to the Mr. Show sketch of 3 + 1 - 1.
That's good.
When it's David Cross and Bob Odenkirk essentially kind of sending up Color Me Bad and a lot of those like late 90s kind of R&B rap influenced sort of music. And they're clearly not fans of this music. It doesn't seem like affectionate mockery. They just seem to be kind of like pissing all over it. And it's still like just incredibly laugh out loud funny. Whereas when you look at the stuff in Popstar, they even went on record as saying, I remember talking to them and they asked me at one point, do you think the film is mean-spirited? And I thought, no, not at all. I mean, it's taking a couple of digs. There's some digs at like Tyler, the Creator, because there's a rap character who's very clearly based on him, like a cross between him and Wiz Khalifa. And he gets a couple of knocks, and some of the EDM folks, like there's the DJ at one point puts on this ridiculous spotlight helmet that clearly looks like a Dead Mouse helmet.
It's Dead Mouse kind of Daft Punk.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Exactly. You can tell that they're kind of like nudging him in the ribs there. But for the most part, I was like, no, I don't think it's mean-spirited at all. And they said, if there's any pop star out here that would be offended by this movie, that would break our hearts. Like, that was clearly not what we set out to do. Not just because they're friends with a lot of those guys. I mean, Justin Timberlake shows up, and, you know, those guys and Justin Timberlake are pretty tight at this point. But the fact is, they never set out to be like, this music's horrible and we hate it. It's like, this is the stuff we listen to and it's kind of ridiculous. And this is our chance to take those aspects and, like they said, just amp them up to an absurd level. But I have a question for you, Rob Sheffield.
Yes, David.
Even though they have said that this character, Connor for real, is not solely based on Justin Bieber, there's a lot of Bieber aspects in it. Do you think that it's possible to actually parody somebody like Justin Bieber, who very often, and like most pop stars in the kind of contemporary pop landscape, almost seem like parodies of themselves to begin with?
Well, that's an excellent question. I'd like to hear Rob's answer to this. I mean, especially that one year with Bieber where he was going through airport security with monkeys and the lost year.
The thing about all these pop stars, you can't argue that they don't realize that they're funny, and you can't argue that they're not funny on purpose. And Justin Bieber is hilarious and has always been hilarious.
Going back to the Chris Rock thing about NWA, yes.
Yes, embracing the comedy ridiculousness of it all. I don't know if you remember the Video Music Awards where he arrived wearing his smart lesbian grad student glasses and carrying his pet snake, who was named Johnson.
To be fair, he was reading a lot of bell hooks at the time.
Yeah, exactly, yes. And he was wearing the snake, and Selena Gomez was his date, and I just remember them being interviewed on the red carpet talking to Sway of MTV, and Selena's got this expression on her face saying, this is what boys are like? This is what dates are like? Like, tell me this is not what my future is going to be like. Why is he carrying a snake and wearing those glasses and talking about how being a drummer is really like where all his music comes from, and then proving it by going to a little drum set that happens to be set up right off the red carpet and playing a long drum solo. And there was something... You knew there was absolutely no way that Justin Bieber did not realize the comedy aspects of what they do in any pop star. I mean, you mentioned Katy Perry, that popumentary that she does is a great showcase, like all her actual records for how hilarious she is.
Yeah, you would never accuse Katy Perry of not having a sense of humor, yes. Either about herself or virtually anything.
Yes. So it's the kind of thing where, I mean, it was startling for a lot of people at the time who loved Spinal Tap and hated metal. It was really surprising to them how much metal bands instantly embraced it as homage. I remember Rob Halford from Judas Priest that summer saying, you know, we're having a video machine put on the bus just so we can watch this over and over again on tour. And I remember reading that and thinking, wow, well, you know, if he likes it, since if anyone was going to be offended by it, he would be.
So the film starts off with a concert scene that involves Adam Levine's hologram humping itself. a hologram of two Adam Levines basically grinding up against each other. And when I brought this up to them, the first thing they said was like, Adam Levine's a saint. Like he led us in front of a Maroon 5 concert to get a big crowd scene. He let us come and like film a bunch of shots of Andy walking slow-mo so that we could have something authentic for the movie. And they said the second thing is he not only loves the movie, he's seen it 3 times and it hasn't even come out yet. To which they then said the ultimate goal that we wanted to make for this film, Andy Samberg said, my wife's a musician. She's married to Joanna Newsom. And he goes, the one thing I kept telling her was we just want to make a movie that bands want to watch on their tour bus.
Right.
And, you know, I would argue that though I'm not currently in a pop band, it feels like the kind of movie that bands like One Direction would find really funny, even as they're being ribbed in it, and watch it on their tour bus over and over again and quote lines from it and just kind of make fun of it and be in on the joke.
All right. Well, we talked about CB4 and Spinal Tap. Are there any other like music mockumentaries that you think rise to that level? We mentioned, I'm not sure if Walk Hard quite does. Rob, for your money,
The Ruddles is way up Ruddles. There.
The Ruddles. How did we forget about The Ruddles?
And that's a perfect example of how loving the music is what makes it authentic. The Ruddles movie is by far the best movie made about the Beatles, and that's partly because it's made by people who loved the Beatles so much they were willing to mock aspects of the Beatles that, you know, were not lingua franca at the time. The music is so incredibly funny. The great psychedelic John Lennon ballad, Cheese and Onion. And it's from the movie Yellow Submarine Sandwich, and he's just sitting there playing the piano, the cartoon John, and he's like, I've always thought in the back of my mind, cheese and onion. And it's such a perfect, loving parody. That's what makes it funny, that it's the kind of thing where if there was an aspect of taking a shot at it, then it wouldn't work as comedy because that the whole point is how loving it is. I don't know if you count Hedwig in this kind of thing. I would, but I said I would because
it's certainly got a sense of humor. It's not,
And that it's so full of homages that you would only get if you were totally like crammed with the music of Bowie and Roxy and Lou Reed and Iggy, that there are all these jokes that are designed just for true fans to get. So right. It's a movie like a lot of these that you can watch even if you don't know anything about the genre and find it funny, but there's all these added Easter eggs in there for people who really get the thing that's being parodied.
Which is such a, I mean, it's interesting because, I mean, most big, you know, most movies are made to try to appeal to everyone, but it's kind of the nature of music that you know, great music doesn't always appeal to everyone. Sometimes music is about picking your tribe and just loving this band and going really deep. And so I think your point, to me, it means that like a lot of these great music parodies are like music in the sense that you really, they are for real fans in that sense. I mean, they can be appreciated, but maybe they're not necessarily for a huge audience.
I don't know. I mean, when I think about, The Ruddles is a great example of this. Like you said, a lot of that stuff wasn't necessarily lingua franca. But I imagine a lot of people who would have seen The Ruddles over the Ruddle TV weekend, they ran it, would have seen the All You Need Is Love TV appearance. They would have seen, or at least seen bits of the Magic Mystery Tour TV special. They would have seen the Ed Sullivan stuff. They would have seen a lot of the performance things. They would have known about the, you know, We're Bigger Than Jesus interview. And so in a lot of ways, for the Ruddles to kind of make fun of that, it's not like they were making fun of the MC5. Or the Velvet Underground.
Right.
Like they were making fun of a band, you know, gently making fun of a band that was one of the biggest rock bands in the world still to this day.
A legend to last a lunchtime.
Right. I mean, the Beatles are the perfect topic for a movie like that. Everybody is, the most people are going to get the jokes. Whereas like with Spinal Tap, you know, maybe one of the reasons that Rob Halford loved it is that he was part of the group that got the jokes more than anybody.
Yes. Yeah. What was it? I think maybe it was Steven Tyler that was recently talking about this, and he goes, yeah, Spinal Tap's not a comedy. Spinal Tap's a horror movie. When you're a metal band, Spinal Tap's a horror movie, and yet you will not find bigger advocates for that movie than metal bands. Bruce Dickinson, you know, Rob Halford, like, they love that film because they recognize that, and they recognize how absurd it is to do a set that's made of Stonehenge, much less a set that's made of tiny Stonehenges that are in danger of being crushed by dwarves.
Right.
I love that music parodies that Andy Dick would do on his little MTV variety show. I don't know if you remember those, but but because it was the early 2000s and he was mocking the artists of that time and getting them so precisely right in their details. So there was Kid Christ, who was the Christian rap meddler, who like was full of like all these Kid Rock parodies that, you know, and Marilyn Poppins, who... was the nanny from hell, Daphne Aguilera, but like that he was taking these genres at a time when these are very like, you know, despised by the adult world, teen genres, and approaching them very lovingly from the inside, which sounds like a joke that Daphne Aguilera would make. But that something about, you know, Kid Christ, you have to like really know Kid Rock's work well and his persona well to get why it's comical that he's, you know, always saying, Matthew 3:26, bitch, you know. His big hit is, she's no stranger to my manger. No receipt, I can't exchange her. Say a prayer, my soul's in danger. And that, you know, that he's like doing all these like super, you know, super Christian Kid Rock songs. That there's something always about to combine music and comedy. It really, really helps to just be a passionate fan of the music involved.
People listening to this podcast can't see this, but Nathan and I are actually holding up our lighters. that last song, that was a beautiful rendition, sir.
What should the next music parody be on? Some of the stuff in Popstar made me think that there should be a great EDM parody movie.
Oh, it's ripe. I think it's ripe for parody, that genre at the moment. And maybe certain aspects of modern hip hop. I mean, there are some great digs at various pop stars in pop stars, not just, you know, Bieber and Katy Perry. There's a great scene. One of the funniest scenes in the film is this sort of take on Kanye's very public, very extravagant proposal to Kim Kardashian, and that Connor for real is going to proposed to his girlfriend in this huge field with seals singing and doves being released and wild wolves on the thing. the barrier, and then the wolves get loose.
And a bank of photographers.
Exactly, yeah, and a battle between a lot of paparazzi to capture the intimate, end quote, moment. And then, you know, naturally the wolves get loose, and Seal is mauled by wolves. I don't think that's a spoiler. It's in the trailer. And the funny thing was, they wrote that scene. The concept apparently was Akiva Schaffer's, and they wrote that scene with Seal in it, and they were like, Seal's the only person who can do this.
Wow.
And Seal not only said okay and did it, which they said surprised him. They're like, he was perfectly happy to, you know, say those jokes and make fun of his scars and like do this. They go, but he was being actually attacked by a wild dog with, you know, one of those armbands on to protect him. And they did that scene, they estimate, somewhere between 5 to 10 takes. So there's 5 to 10 takes of Seal gamely running up to a limo and joking about his appearance and then getting like bitten by a trained dog in the arm. That's dedication to comedy.
Amen. I think we've covered a lot of ground on here. David Fear, Rob Sheffield,
Nathan Brackett.
Thanks for coming on.
Thank you.
Always a pleasure.
And that was Tweezer by Phish. I'm here with Associate Editor Patrick Doyle to answer some reader mail on Patrick's recent stories on the band. Can you tell us about these stories, Patrick?
Sure. Trey Anastasio got on the phone to talk about Phish's upcoming summer tour, and I always look forward to talking to him because he doesn't do a lot of interviews, especially about Phish. So somebody was saying, you know, they look forward to the once a year that he does an interview to talk about Phish. So it's always fun.
And he's always like smart and thoughtful and has real very specific things to say. Usually,
absolutely.
Right? Yeah.
Right now he was talking about, he still gets excited after, you know, 31 years of Phish and playing long, you know, extended musical jams with them. And he still gets excited about it. So right now he was talking about how they sort of have learned how to communicate in like a real melodic way, and every jam sort of has a purpose to it, and he just has an interesting take on their playing at any given time.
I thought some of the stuff about his post-show routine and the band's post-show routine was really interesting.
Yeah, that's another example of what he gets excited about. You know, you'd think that after 30 years that they would just kind of clock in, leave the show, and then get on stage the next night and do it again, but the minute they all have their separate buses, but they're texting all the time after a show. They have a group Phish text, and you know, they say, hey, do you remember that little part of Harry Hood? Or, you know, they all know what they're talking about because they're so sort of inside each other's head after these many years. You know, Trey will say that I could tell when Mike Gordon was going through his divorce what was going on in his life, because the way he was playing, he wasn't quite there with the rest of us. And it sort of described it like a boat that they're all on trying to row
right.
together.
They know each other so well at this point, right?
So he was talking about what he does after the show. So they get on the bus and then they're all talking about the show. And then the next day, Trey will wake up and make his coffee and turn on his iPhone and open the Phish apps. There's a couple apps. One of them is Live Phish, which is the official app. And then the other one is called Phish OD, which is Phish on Demand, which is a fan-made app that the fans didn't even know that Trey knew about, but it turns out he uses it every day. And he's constantly trying to figure out the perfect guitar tone. So he's listening to both the Phish OD app, which is fan microphones, and then the Live Phish app, which is the soundboard, actual soundboard. He's hearing where it's what it sounds like on both of them, and he uses that to figure out his sound.
Wow, that's amazing to be that like kind of still like geeked out about your show and your craft and looking at being a real student of it.
Yeah.
You know, after this many years.
Yeah, absolutely.
Here, let's read some of the letters. One was from maybe a doubter. D Benson U2 is the username. I wonder how popular Phish and the Dead would be if not for the invention of LSD. I mean, that's a kind of like the classic criticism, right?
Yeah, and there's plenty of people who don't do that, who go to the shows, you know?
Right, right. Okay, this is from a user named Cliff. Gotta say, I've been a Deadhead for years and only appreciated Phish from afar. I went to Magna Ball last year. That's one of their, help me out,
their
band, yearly festival?
Yeah, they put on festivals. This was the one last year that they really kind of staged a festival that is, they play nighttime, midnight sets, and it's just sort of their own curated
right.
thing.
Right. And they usually have it in...
All over the place.
Right.
A lot of times in the east, northeast.
Right. Anyway, I went to Magna Ball last year, and it was hands down the greatest concert festival experience of my life. All the guys in Phish seem so down to earth and ego-free, mm-hmm. unlike some members of the Dead. Cough, Phil, cough.
Oh.
They are really easy to love and root for. Can't wait for lock-in.
Yeah, they don't play a lot of festivals, but the one they are doing this summer is lock-in in Virginia.
Right. Some of the other letters we got are touched on John Fishman of the band's political activism.
Yeah.
Do you want to tell us a little bit about what he's been up to?
He has been on the road playing, sitting in with, he sat in with my friend's band in Maine at a Bernie rally. He's been on, as Trey calls it, the Bernie tour, and he's just getting the word out about Bernie. And even though it's been sort of reported that Trey is also on board with that, I asked Trey about Bernie, and he would not commit to saying anything politically because he said that kind of gets in the way of the music and the experience when people come see you live. He kind of referenced Jimi Hendrix said something like that, that he was not going to speak about the revolution. He'd rather, if he has to choose Frank Sinatra or the revolution, I'll choose Frank Sinatra. So, yeah, he's been on the road just, you know, campaigning for Bernie, and Bernie called Phish one of America's great bands.
So, all right. Well, yeah. You know, Bernie's got some Vermont cred, obviously, yeah. So he knows some Phish, I'm sure.
Yeah.
Okay, here's a comment from somebody named KiteFlyer89. I feel it's very hard to say I like Phish and I like Bernie Sanders without falling into a very specific stereotype. But I like Phish and Bernie Sanders.
Yeah.
Okay, I am actually posting high right now, but that's a coincidence. Maybe it's not a coincidence.
And Bill O'Reilly does those, you know, heavily edited montages of Bernie people. I feel like they're looking out for these type of people.
Right.
You know?
The watch out, KiteFlyer89. Yeah. This is from a reader named Tom Vader. All musicians should stay far, far away from politicians. You work way too hard earning that public capital to squander it on a foolish partisan talking point. There's literally nothing to be gained by endorsing any of them. What you will do is allow them to post about it on social media as if your musicianship qualifies you to pick a leader for everyone else and alienates anyone who might have liked you and your art but dislikes your politician. If that's what you want, then you're doing it right.
Mm.
We had a whole episode about whether musicians should be involved in politics, and
yeah.
We could debate that. I will say this, though. You know, hey, Chris Christie is still a Bruce Springsteen fan.
Right.
Even though, Bruce, they have very different politics. So, hey, it's not. I don't think it's always the case.
Yeah, and Bon Jovi was just out with Hillary
right.
Yesterday.
Right. This is from one of our frequent commenters, Get to Work People.
He is.
I like the way Trey doesn't want to get political. Good. Go out and play good music and entertain. He's echoing Tom Vader's thoughts.
Mm-hmm.
These thoughts are also echoed by somebody named Strictly Hines 57. thanks, Trey, for not mixing politics and Phish. Reaching the conscious thought objective is easier when we are not thinking of our concert neighbor's political position.
Mm-hmm.
I have always felt Phish provided a great platform for escaping these realities. In the end, helping us to see these past worldly differences and connect on a metaphysical level. Shameless song request. Tweezer going into Life Boy
yeah.
in Portland, Maine, please.
Oh,
smiley face.
I'm going to be at that show, so.
All right, we'll see.
I hope
we'll
he does
see. That was a thoughtful comment, you know, that definitely had some metaphysical points from a real Phish fan.
Yeah.
So we'll see if they do Tweezer and Life Boy.
Yeah.
Well, I think that's it for Reader Mail, Patrick, but thanks for coming on.
Thanks, Nathan.
Thanks for listening to Rolling Stone Music Now. If you like what you heard, please leave a review on the iTunes Store or wherever you get your podcasts.